First effort and then the second effort. Right, there's the. Can you see that? There we are. Very nice. That's the one I got. And thank you all for your screenshots. Oh, I did get one picture. She was looking away and not in focus. Right, good. Thank you, everybody, for all of your lovely screenshots, which will be unquestionably better than my photographs, even though I was sitting right next to the thing. It's largely about the composition of the photograph than the equipment, you know, far more than the equipment or the various settings and things. If you have an eye for framing, that's where the art of the whole thing comes. And I definitely don't have it in the same way Scott had that, for example, beautifully. But the other thing, I mean, Justin, if you're getting into wildlife photography, so I suppose if you're a novice like I am, then for me, this little camera of mine is quite nice because what it does, although it's slow, you know, it does make me even slower than I am normally. But what it does is that it's got this kind of digital representation of what you see when you are taking a photograph, which means that you can run it on full manual and see exactly before you've taken the photograph what it's going to look like. And I think that's been a really good way for me to learn the differences between taking photographs at different f-stops and different ISOs and different shutter speeds. So yeah, that would be my advice. Get a camera that you can operate in full manual and then you can really learn about it. But other than that, I would ask Brent the same thing. Okay, let's head across. I think we're going across to Brent for an update. Let's get an update from him and I'll catch up with you in the clearings.
Well, we're still hot on the trail of Karula and she still looks like she's hunting. Here is her track. You can see how fresh that is. You can see that the sand is still very depressed over there, almost shiny in actual fact. If I had to take my hand, for instance, and push it into the sand, you'll notice the same clean pressed quality over there as what this track has. Have a look at that. So the sand hasn't had a time to roll down these embankments or to decompress. And you can just have a look at that. Very, very good looking track. It's what trackers call a shining track. It's the track that you most likely to find an animal at the end of is a track like this. Now, she looks like she's hunting. She is walking on a road. We've been following her on a road a little bit. Animals like to walk on roads. They like to walk on game paths, luckily. Otherwise, we'd have a much tougher time finding them. And I don't see any evidence of her cubs with her. So what she's done, in all likelihood, is stashed her cubs somewhere and is off hunting. This would have most likely have been at some point in the last 4 hours or so. It takes about 4 hours for a track to start losing this particular type of crispness. And so she would have been here already around about 2 to 3 o'clock this morning, or as literally as little as 30 minutes ago. Quite tough to say. What we'd be looking for is tracks of birds over this. So that'll give me an idea of when. If birds are more likely to come across a track like this, then we know it was done pre-dawn. And if it's just insects over tracks, we know that it was done, or post-dawn at least, then we know if it's just insects, it was pre-dawn. Right now, nothing has walked on top of Karula's tracks except for us. Nice. Right. Well, while we carry on looking for a leopard, Brent is sitting with some lions for you. Wow.
Look at that. Cheeky little cub. Sorry guys, I've just got to be on the game drive. We've just found them. There we go. These two little ones seem to be terrorizing the Birmingham boy. They're two Birmingham boys. We can only see one. And look at him, scent marking. Sorry guys, there's a lot of noise in my ear, but I'm gonna ignore it now. So we're with the whole Nguma pride. So our general mission for the morning has been a success. It sounds like they have Well, I know they've killed a buffalo, and I walked in here, and we found them on foot. And it actually happened that Aubrey and I both found them at about the same time from a different direction. So they got a bit of a fright. They ran away from the buffalo kill, but I'm 100% sure they're going to move back to it shortly. And it's all five lionesses and two Birminghams that I can see. There could be a third. Who knows? So there's one Birmingham there. There's the second lioness. And then the cubs are spread between all of them. Now, there could only be five cubs here at the moment. There could be eight. It just depends. We don't know whether that single lioness has left the smallest cubs hidden away and will only bring them to the carcass a little later. So I can see one, two, three, four cubs. Five cubs. Now, Sally in Oregon says she gets nervous with males around the cubs. It is, oh, hello, Ma. It is quite normal, and they are going to have to get used to it and know when and when not to push the big boys. So you can hear the vultures in the trees around us. And isn't that incredible? We could not see the vultures early this morning just because of all the mist. What's going on now? Come on, girls, time to go back to your dinner. Michael's wondering, why is it when lions kill other predators, they don't eat the carcass, whereas hyenas seem to do that? Well, it depends on how hungry they are. I'm pretty sure they don't taste too good, leopards and other lions and hyenas. Hyenas are the ultimate scavenger, so they will take advantage of any food source possible. Okay, there we go. Lioness is up, and so you're going to start heading towards the carcass. I just need to let Aubrey, they're going to all start heading towards the carcass. Okay, so I'm going to try make my way through this very thick, very, very thick bush to try get to where Aubrey is with the buffalo kill. So I do apologize if there's lots of noise. It's going to be quite an adventure getting through here. So while we do that, let's go back to James and see what he's up to.
Well, that's a good turn up for the books, isn't it? The lions, brilliant stuff. Hopefully they'll start feeding on that carcass fairly soon, and then there will be great activity. We have arrived in the great plains of Cheetah and hoping desperately to find something in these clearings. Maybe Inkanyeni. We're going to go to the sort of last position where she was stalking yesterday, but maybe there will be some ostriches and I will be able to attempt the great ostrich attracting dance that we did the other day. But things look fairly empty out here, don't you, Savium? That's move very slowly down through here. Hello, Vincent in Ohio. I'm just going to look over there across to those clearings. And you see the far clearings there where that pile of sticks is there, Vim. You say you're thinking of coming to Africa, and you, where is the best place to see rhino and giraffe and what was the other one? Cheetah. Rhino, giraffe, and cheetah. Well, Vincent, there are a number of places. It really does, as I've said before, many times depend quite a lot on your budget. If you want to see rhino and giraffe and cheetah, well, rhino and giraffe you can see just about anywhere here in the Kruger. You can see them in some of the Natal parks down Mfolozi, Mhluhluwe, for example. You can see them in some of the private reserves around what we call the Waterberg, which is up to the north of us. But if you want to see all three of those things and you want to see them in great profusion, I would say the best place to see them is a place called Pinda. And Pinda is in northern KwaZulu-Natal. And it's a magnificent reserve that was reclaimed from farmland. Brent did quite a lot of his growing up, actually, at Pinda. And Pinda is famous for its cheetah. You will definitely see giraffe there, and they've got plenty of rhino, both black and white. So I would go to Pinda, Vincent. But it does depend on your budget. It ain't a cheap holiday at Pinda. I mean, supreme luxury, but it's not very cheap. So it really does depend on your budget. If you come to Kruger, you've got a good chance of seeing rhino and giraffe. Smaller chance of seeing cheetah because it's just quite difficult to see them here. All right, let's go across to Brent. I think he's back with the lions.
Okay, so the first lioness is arriving back. The vultures, some of them have taken off. The others are being a little bit brave. There's a couple still low. And if we come out, Brian... Oh, no, it didn't wait. It decided to get off the ground. I have seen lions kill vultures around a kill before. Okay, well, they're moving in to that carcass. So it looks like they killed a buffalo. I think this might have been killed by the male and a single female yesterday, because the rest of the pride weren't around, and these vultures were here apparently yesterday on the sunset safari, but were seen right at the end of the safari. Yeah, we'll just let her pass first, and then the rest of the pride are moving in. We'll try to get into a good spot shortly. That's Amber Eyes. Now it's going to be interesting to see what happens when the males get in here. Like a big buffalo bull. Quite smelly. So there we go. The other lions are gonna come in from behind us. There we go, that's Here they come. Jason says, cubs by a feeding male, very intense to watch. It is, but the male lions are generally more tolerant of cubs eating with them than they would be with, for example, one of the adult lionesses. And they might be a little bit nervous about feeding because there are two males that are still coming in behind us. And she's calling for the cubs. The first of the cubs is arriving. I think all the audio we heard last night of hyenas and lions would would have been because of this carcass. Now, unfortunately for us, the best spot happens to be directly downwind of this quite smelly buffalo. Ryan, can you do me a favor? Look over your shoulder, see if any of the males are on the way.
Not yet.
Not yet. So there we go. You can see the one lioness is going to take advantage before the males arrive. Noises. So I'm just keeping quiet and watching what's going on. Now there's something going on that's sending the lions back away. They're acting quite strange. You see the cubs immediately follow. Is there a greeting going on behind us or? I'm not sure. Let's just move a little bit. Unfortunately, we can get away from this quite pungent smell we're experiencing at the moment. Now, if you've ever had a deep freeze stop working, that's exactly what it smells like, a deep freeze that hasn't been working for about 2 weeks. Now, the possibility of what could be happening is it could be that the three smallest cubs are not feeling as brave. There's probably been lots of hyenas not too far away from here. Oh, I'm just going to sit here and wait. I'm not sure what spooked them. Andrew's wondering, are there any animals that can kill a male lion? Yes, Andrew, another male lion. And if he's in fine form or in his prime of his life, it's generally going to be another male lion. An elephant, possibly. A buffalo. Rhino. A hippo. There's one lioness still here. The others have moved back to where we first found them, where the males are. Now, I wonder if they've heard a male lion that we haven't heard. That might not be a Birmingham boy. And it's going to be very interesting to see how this plays out. This lioness might be staying to protect the carcass from vultures. There's lots of vultures around. But, okay, she looks like she's heading back to the carcass, making sure no vultures even think about it. Again, she's also moving off again. Oh, she going to move quite far off? Or is she going to lie down close by again to make sure the vultures don't come through? It looks like she is going to follow the rest of the pride. Okay, I think we're going to go see what's happening with the rest of the pride. And again, we're going to have to go through these very thick little monkey oranges, so it does make an incredible noise. And I just, very interesting behavior we're seeing now. And I think it's too early to speculate what's going on. So I think we just need to watch for a little bit longer before we start making any assumptions about what's cracking. So while we try to figure out what's going on with these lions and catch up with them again, let's go see how Steph's tracking of Queen Karula is going.
Particular case, not going too well. We seem to have lost the tracks going into a particularly hard sanded block, which is not too much of a story. We'll eventually find where she came out of this block, but all the time, how we do it is we basically crisscross all the game paths in that area in the line that they were in, the direction that that leopard was walking in. The direction Karula was walking in was straight east, and we hope to find her tracks on one of the game paths exiting this. Where we are now is quite sandy, but where we lost her tracks just now was definitely not. So we've come into an area that holds tracks a little bit easier, and in the hope that we find where that goes. And in the meantime, it's always a good thing, while we're busy walking, you stop and you listen. As Karula is moving through this area, she is going to be disturbing animals. Things like Nyala, a lot of Nyala around at the moment, quite a few Impala, and then monkeys also. The little vervet monkeys are feeding in the riverbeds close to where she's heading. In that easterly direction, she's heading down towards the Mulwati and basically in the direction of Vuyatela camp. So I have no doubt that she'll pop out at some point. Either we will hear her or we'll find her this afternoon. But in the meantime, it's just lovely to be on a stroll in this particular area. There's a bit of a breeze that's blowing out of the east at the moment, and it's carrying with it, it's slightly cold, but it's also carrying with it a scent. And I think what's happened is there's a few acacias around here, a few of the knobthorns that have started to flower, and I think this perfumed air that we're smelling at the moment is from these first acacias that are busy flowering. Now, Anna Marie, you've asked me for a snake. Could I find a snake? I'll be honest with you that it's going to be really difficult to find you a snake this time of the year, and especially this time of the day. Most snakes are in a type of slumber, not quite a hibernation, but they go into a period of deactivity when prey species are at a minimum, when there's not a lot of water around, and when the temperature is quite cold. So apart from puff adder, which we do find in the middle of the day here, it's just a small window of opportunity to see snakes. Around about, I would say, 11 to about 2 o'clock is the prime time window for snakes at the moment. So way too early for them. However, I'm not saying that we won't find them, and for you, I'll definitely keep my eyes open. Things like birds giving alarm calls, and then also sunny patches on the sides of termite mounds are brilliant places to look for snakes around this time of the year, and that's exactly what I'm going to hope to try and find for you. Right, let's move through here, Xander. See if we can get your aerial threaded through these trees. Right, and while we keep on looking at game paths, and just as an example of a game path, this is a game path. You can see that it's an area moving between those two trees, and then it goes left. That's basically what we're looking. We're searching all these paths for Karula's tracks. But while we do that, and while we have something else to show you, James has an elephant. Off you go.
It's a fairly nervy herd of elephants here in Cheetah Plains, everybody. It's just come south from the pan. It was having a drink there. They were having a drink. 5 of them. They just don't seem that relaxed. But as we stop the car, they're starting to slow down their movements. I think they're probably going to go and find some woodland to feed in. The matriarch up front there. And I suspect probably one other adult and the rest of her offspring. Small herd. And I said to you at the beginning of this dry season, I said, you know, these herds congregate, they get much bigger and aggregate during the wet season because the water is so much more concentrated. And that really, I don't think, has happened this year at all. In fact, if anything, the opposite has happened. And maybe that's because their diets are so widely sort of dispersed and they eat such a wide variety of different foods. Right, let me move forward. They seem to have relaxed a little bit with us. Any animal, remember every single animal out here has got a predator, if not a few predators. I'm just going to speak quietly and we're going to watch the matriarch there. That's not the matriarch, obviously, that's a youngster. The matriarch is just to the right there. And she's the one that when we walked up, she lifted her front foot and she was just a little bit nervous. Andrew, I think that if you look at things like polar bears, what else? Polar bears and perhaps crocodiles. I think adults of polar bears and crocodiles probably don't experience anything like the same amount of fear, or I'm not sure you can term it fear, but sort of a predator avoidance strategies that many of the animals out here have. An adult polar bear clearly has no predators, nor does a big nor does a big adult crocodile. But when they're little, they do have predators, and they have other things that can threaten them. Crocodiles would be threatened by drought situations like this. Polar bears, of course, threatened by climate change, threatened by changing environmental conditions. And if they can't find enough to eat, well, then, you know, it's quite possible that they could die. So, you know, do they fear predators? No, probably not. Do they experience a sense of what we might term fear? Yes, I imagine that they do. It's a very nice question, Andrew. And we were trying to define, Brian and I were chatting the other day about what fear actually is. You know, how do you define it for an animal like this? Does an impala actually feel fear, or does it just go about its life in a state of constant terror and not actually realize that it's going through a constant state of terror? All right, let's quickly go back to Brent. He's got the lions walking past his cart. Find out about his fear.
I might go back to that kill, but yeah, we are live. My earpiece was out. Sorry about that. And just discussing what they might do. And they've, they're definitely nervous about something. It could be because of the amount of hyenas that were making noise last night with the cubs around. And also, it looks like one of the male lions has amorous intentions with one of the females. And the three smallest cubs are not here. And it's unlikely that they'll all go to fetch her, fetch them. But as I see, they stop. Some of the lionesses have stopped. They're looking back towards the carcass. They're listening. I'm pretty sure they can hear the vultures descending on it. But with cubs, they've probably decided it's not worth the risk if they're not feeling comfortable. They've got eaten a reasonable amount. Now, only one male seems to have followed. The second male might head back towards that carcass. Now, I've got a suspicion that these ladies did not kill that buffalo. I think, if anything, one of the males did. And the reason I think that is because the smell of that buffalo is definitely not a kill from yesterday. I think that kill's been there for a day or two, and we must have just missed the vultures. Okay, let's just go forward a bit. I don't want to lose them, but I can see the male's got lazy in his following. Both males are coming through now. Now, one of the two lionesses that doesn't have cubs yet must be either in estrus or about to come into estrus for these two chaps to Three. There's three males. Oh, look at that. Coalition love. It's always incredible how affectionate these big boys can be when not competing for food or females. So there's three Birminghams here. I only saw two earlier. Hello, big boys. That's Mr. Split in the Lip. They are turning into magnificent animals as their coats or their manes get darker. Now, see, this throws credence to my theory that it was one of them who killed it. Look at this guy. He's so much, the one at the back is so much fatter than the other two. Smelling where one of the females urinated. So I'm pretty sure we're going to see a Fleming grimace shortly. Oh, it's so nice to have three of them together. Big boys, smelling, smelling, smelling. There's the Fleming grimace. There we go. I think she's about 5 days from being ready to mate. No, I disagree. 4 days is what I say. So all three males smelling where one of the females urinated. So they're taking that scent over their Jacobson's organ. And that will pass on information like estrus cycles, all those type of things. I'm very, very interested in where she is, where she's urinated. They do look slightly ridiculous when they are doing the Fleming grimace. Now, the fact that three male lions have left that much meat on a buffalo really leads me to believe that one of those females is very close to being in estrus. Let's just move a little bit. Off after the ladies. Now, Shamsung's wondering, why do male lions scent mark when they're close to cubs? Well, it's not only when they're close to cubs, Shamsung, it's male lions scent mark all the time. That's sort of part and parcel of what they're designed to do. Sorry, it was Mary Ann's question. Focused so much on what's happening around us. I apologize for getting those mixed up. Okay, he's on the move. What we're going to do is try get ahead to where the females and cubs are again, because the males will follow. So I'm going to go a little bit wider from them and around to where there's a slightly more open patch of bush for me to negotiate. Aubrey, Aubrey. So while we get into that position, let's go see how James is doing in the far east.
Everyone, we've left those elephants. We sat with her for a little while and then we tried to move a little bit closer and she kind of came bucketing out the bush towards us. So we moved off and she followed us down the road for some time and made a bit of a noise. very strange, so I just thought we'd move away and rather not harass her any further. But right from the very beginning, a lovely sighting of what I think is a bird we do not see here very often at all. It's a striped kingfisher, I think. You see it there? Or has it flown off? Sorry everyone, I think we missed the striped kingfisher. It's like, almost like a brown hooded kingfisher, but half the size. And this is not woodland king, at least this is not brown hooded kingfisher kind of territory. So that would have been really nice. Please can someone let me know if you've seen striped kingfisher. I haven't seen them since I've been here at Djuma, and I used to see them quite a lot down in the south. Lovely swizzling call. Anyway, that elephant was not happy with us, and so we left her. We watched her for a little while, and she came up onto a termite mound and kind of gave us a bit of a groan. And then as we walked, we drove past her at about 20 meters. She just turned and came. And so we thought we'd probably better leave. I don't think VM and I either of us felt like she was going to do a tremendous amount of damage, but she was definitely going to hit the car. Anyway, so we decided to leave her. That's an interesting one. There are lots of different approaches that people have to dealing with elephants like that. Some people think that it's a good idea to bang the car and stop. Or leave the engine running, certainly if she's already in charge. My approach is one that if an animal like that says, well, I don't really want you around, you just leave. I'm under no false illusions as to who's the boss. You'll sometimes hear people say, well, you've got to show them who's boss. I agree completely. They know exactly who's boss. I'm under no illusions. Anyway, we'll try and find some others. We'll go towards three in a row pan. Oh, Dyker. Viam, you reacted there like a scalded cat. Viam saw a Dyker, everybody. He doesn't normally react when he sees a Dyker. Anything that moves. Unless it's a kudu or a giraffe. Giraffe move. The other thing I'm trying to find over here, everyone, is a fig tree. I was reading about the fig trees yesterday, 2 days ago. Oh, here's some more elephants. Let's see if these ones like us a little bit more than the others did. Oh, this is a big herd. There's a very large roadblock going on here. This is very nice. Good stuff. Now, immediately these ones indicate that they are a lot more relaxed than the others. The first thing I noticed about that first cow we saw was the fact that she stopped, turned her head slightly, lifted her front leg and sort of swung it from side to side as she thought about what we wanted and assessed whether we were a threat to her herd. That's not happened here. These chaps have just carried on eating. And I say chaps, I mean that's a big cow there you're looking at. There's another big cow coming out to the right-hand side of us. All right, let's go back to the lions. They're now moving again.
So the females and cubs have already gone into this river system. I can hear them, but I can't see them. And the one male is about to join them in the thickets there. We still do have two males out in front of us, but I think they're probably going to head that way shortly. Oh! They're going to be nice and lie down. I thought they were going to disappear into the river. But it's so awesome to have three of the Birmingham boys. We haven't seen too many of them all together for a while, so hopefully the fourth will also make an appearance. I can hear the cubs. They're just in here. It sounds like they're fighting over suckling. Yes, that's exactly what they're doing. Mom just told them to stop it. Can you see anything in there, Brian?
No.
It is an impenetrable area. Well, should we have a try? Let's have a see if we can see anything. We can hear them, so they are close. Oh, wait, look at that. We don't want to drive over his bottom. That's the male. It looks like we might get a half chance. We can see two of the lionesses grooming. The cubs are a bit further in. Noisy little critters. And, probably about 6 foot to our right is one of the Birmingham boys. But we're going to try see if we can maneuver through here. While we do that, let's go back to James and incredible elephants.
Last shot. Doing some beautiful artwork there, everybody. Here these elephants are doing a bit of bush clearing, much more relaxed than the other chaps, and they are basically just feeding through this woodland, eating bark and rootstock. That's all they can find to eat. There's not much else for them to get at here. And quite a few of them, and two enormous cows, and I wonder if that's why they're not more relaxed than the other ones. It's entirely possible that because they're so big, they're that much more experienced, that much older, and so they've seen cars before. And as Wim pointed out to me, that other herd could easily have come out of the Kruger, you know, which means they don't see vehicles nearly as much as these ones, especially not open-topped ones with two people in them and that very large aerial sticking out the back. So maybe that's why they were unhappy with us. Anyway, this lot doesn't seem to care much at all about us. Interesting wind blowing today. Seems to be coming from the northeast. That is strange. That means it's coming up off the Indian Ocean. That's where the cyclone storms come from. You can just see it starting to pick up now. Oh, that's really quite eerie, the way it whistles through these trees. It's been such a still, still morning. Djuma Dam Pan, there's a lioness eating there, or not eating, she's drinking there. I'm sure it's the mother of the three little ones. We didn't know where they were, and watch her carefully. I suspect that what she will do is head off in an easterly direction away from the pan towards Mvubu Road, I suspect, and into that drainage system there. I think that's where her babies are. Now this elephant looks to me like she's listening to me talking, not particularly interestedly, but that she's listening to my voice while she eats her breakfast, thinking, I wonder if he's telling the truth, or perhaps she's so experienced and so wise that she's thinking to herself, what an idiot. Look how she's totally cleaned that branch of bark. Oops, I've pulled myself out. James Richard, I did pull myself out there, so I'm sorry, I don't know if I got your question correctly, but from what I could hear, you're wondering, given their longevity, do they get cataracts and other things like that, or diseases or maladies that might come with age, in the same way that humans do? James, ooh, what's this? I think this tree's going to cop it. James, I don't think so, no. And I'll tell you why I don't think so. Look at this. Oh, wow. Well, that's just a little piece of it. That's okay. Another delicious piece of bark to eat. She's trying to get it in her mouth so she can just pull it off. It's hard work being an elephant and finding enough to eat. James, as with the cancer discussion that we've had, and I'm sure you've heard us have, the diabetes one that we've had, I think you'll find that most of the diseases that affect human beings in old age are possibly not brought on by old age, but rather by lifestyle and what we eat. And yes, I imagine cataracts are possible in these wild animals. Remember, it would be unlikely that we'd see them because they'd die very quickly if they went blind. But I think it's much less likely than it is in domestic stock or in human beings, because these animals live in the environment that they have for millennia and millennia, and sometimes millions of years. They eat what they evolved to eat. They have a lifestyle that they have got used to for many, many thousands, and like I say, in some cases, millions of years. Human beings, not so much. We live in big cities, we inhale horrible things, we eat absolute rubbish, and we take all sorts of supposedly disease-preventing medicines, and we live lives of high stress and very little exercise, and then we are deeply surprised when we get sick. And I think you'll find that most of the animals out here just don't suffer from those diseases because they don't live like that. Another good example is of domestic pets. You know, domestic pets get all sorts of cancers and horrible diseases. And I think that's got to do with what we feed them as well. I know that much of the most expensive dog foods you can buy, for example, have grains. No dog has evolved to eat grains. That's so nice to see. I don't want to move forward because she's having such a lovely breakfast and we've got such a lovely long lens on this car, so I don't think we need to move forward. The rest of them are just easing their way down into the dip to the south of us. And you know, while we're looking at this elephant eating and eating the bark and the cambium layer that she's been designed to eat, people out here in these wilderness areas, that in these villages, the poverty-stricken people that live in the villages where, outside the reserve, many of them, they say that the human lifespan, you know, has expanded. You know, I suppose we have more people live to old age now than they ever did before. But you know, you find old people in these villages who are not infirm, who are not senile. They don't get mental dementia, hardly ever hear of that. They don't get, yes, they do sometimes get cataracts, but they're just a lot more vital, you know, than old people often in Western society, where I think our lifestyles have really taken a toll on our bodies. Whereas even if you're poor, there's quite a lot of relaxing and sitting around that goes on, and I think that that makes a big difference to our ability to live to old age in good health. This is an amazing shot, yes. Isn't that incredible? That poor tree must, every time the elephant takes another piece off, I'm sure it thinks to itself, I should be okay now. And then this very hungry elephant cow takes another piece off. See how important the tusks are and the trunk. And you can see how an elephant that does not have one or the other, or was missing a tusk, or, and you know, we've seen a number of elephants recently that are missing trunks, you can see how it must affect them, but they adapt. Now that's a piece of red thorn, or at least red bush willow, that's being eaten there. The densest wood that we get here, which means it's the strongest wood that we get here. 1,230 kilograms per cubic meter. Now, in imperial measure, that is roughly 2,500 pounds per cubic, per 3 cubic feet. Yeah, per 3 cubic feet. No, 9 cubic feet. Per 9 cubic feet. I don't know if that's how you measure density in the 18th century, but that's basically how it is in the imperial system. So it's massively hard, very difficult to break. And what I'd like to do, if we still have time, once this elephant moves off, I'll go off and I'll hang from a tree of the same, and you'll see that even my vast mass of 68 kilograms doesn't manage to break a tree like that. Shall we move a little bit closer? Oh, there goes the rest of the tree. I'm just going to do that. Oh, shame. And as I do this, everybody, what I want you to take note of is the fact that this is not this tree's first rodeo. That tree has been hammered many times before. This is not the first season of smashing that it has taken. And you might even find that that entire agglomeration there to the right-hand side of your picture and then to the left, that that is one organism. You could well find that that's one tree. Goodness, isn't that amazing? You can also see why these tusks break and how any kind of weakness in the tusk could result in a snap. You've had enough now, have you? She's huge. She's a massive cow. I don't mean that in a derogatory term way, madam. Here in the background, you can hear another tree being felled. Vimpy, just off to our left-hand side, there's another herd. And let's just watch carefully, see if that big cow in the front there has got more than one tusk. She does. It's not the same herd that set themselves at us earlier. Now, this cow in front of us is listening. She's listening about these to these ones. She's reacted to how they're moving. All right, well, as she moves off, let's head across to the lion cubs and see what's going on with them.
So they've gone static about 800 meters from the kill on the That doesn't make sense, does it, dear Smith? Well, this massive little... did it again! This massive river system. It's quite big in this area with these very steep ravines. And Brian and I have managed somehow to get in to the ravine, but this is the best view. We're sitting at quite the angle. It's quite nice because I'm permanently reclining because our nose is feeling up. Brian is permanently about to fall off the vehicle on the back. But it is the only way we can get a view of them at the moment. So I think we're going to leave them. It looks like they're settling down. I think there's a strong possibility that they might try go back towards that buffalo carcass a little later, depending on how they're feeling. But the males are still lying out in the open. So we were trying to get you the best possible view of the little cubs. But unfortunately, alas, this is the best view and it's not the greatest. So what we're going to do is probably move from here and get back up on top to where we can see those gorgeous Birmingham boys. You can see I'm at permanent recline. I don't even have to try. And while I recline my way out of this river system,
and hopefully don't lose Brian. Let's go see how Steph's doing on foot.
All right, we've got such a nice story developing with these leopard tracks. It's actually quite interesting. Is that where we first found Karula's tracks at Trias Dam this morning, she walked a little bit of a circle and then she walked through a drainage line, changed direction almost 180 degrees. She's now walking parallel to the path that she came in on. She's now walking parallel through the bush, but she's joined a male's tracks. So what's happened is Karula's come to Trias Dam, and a male leopard has also been to Trias Dam. But the male leopard was walking in the direction of Karula's cubs. She was walking away from another direction. What's happened now is she's changed her mind and they are now walking parallel, and tracks are the same age as one another. Male leopard and Karula. Karula's cubs are on this side of me here, somewhere in the block here. She is in my mind blocking this male from walking in the direction he wanted to walk in. Their tracks are parallel to one another. He has come and marked on this particular tree, and I want to show you where his tracks were. He lay down here, just on the other side of this bush. Let me show you where his tracks come in. That piece of depressed sand is where a male leopard has lain down. I want to show you where his tracks come into this area and then go out. This is where he lay. Now to find you a nice track, here we go. This is his track here. You can see the toes and the sand there. Now the wind has picked up in the last sort of 20 minutes, so it doesn't look as fresh as what it was looking literally 10 or 15 minutes ago. But these leopard tracks are the same tracks from at the same time that Karula sent them. And here he walked here, there's his next track. Here's his next track here. Here's his next track here. And then he lay down here to groom himself. There's also a hyena here. I thought that him and a hyena may have had a bit of a scrap with one another, but it just looks like he lay down. And then he came here. Here's where he left again. Have a look at what we're looking at. That's literally a fresh male leopard track, all this area here. And then from here, he walked to that tree. And let me show you. Come with for this little piece of the journey. Step, 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 step. Here can confirm his track again. There's his track there. One, two, three toes that I can see and some of the pad. And then here he went. Here he went. There's another track there. And then he walked right up to this tree. Here's a track here, the back of his pad. There's a toe, one toe, two toe, three toes, and there's one piece of his pad. And then he walked here. And if you look up, the trick with leopards is to always look up and almost to get down to their head level and look up. And if I take a vector of where he's going to go, I expect him to be heading towards that marula tree over there for another dab of scent marking. So let's go and have a look there for his tracks. Hopefully I can at the same time show you Karula's tracks here. Her tracks are just on a game path here somewhere. Let's see if I can find them for you here. Her tracks are coming through here somewhere, but I'll just keep my eye open so that I can show you, prove my point. Here's some more of his tracks. He has this male leopard track here. Yeah. Now the trick with these types of things is not really to follow the track for track. It's going to take you too long. What you really want to do is try and project in your mind where this leopard is going to be. And that's what we're going to try and do now, to try and save some time. But in the meantime, we're going to send you back to James, and we'll have some more news in a bit.
Ah, hello everybody. VM likes to surprise you. So I'm here on this tree, It is two organisms, they're two different species of tree here, but I'm sitting on the piece of tree that she broke with her trunk, and I still can't break it any further because she is so strong and I am not. Amazing. Right, so this is the red bush willow. Now I've got Viam, who is always hungry. Well, not as hungry as Connor, but somewhat hungry. I got him some chips. You can see I've presented them beautifully. I have carved them with my knife from the tree, and that is what the elephant has been eating. Viam, here you are. Is that delicious?
Fruity.
It's fruity, is it?
No, but not in taste, in texture.
And in taste?
Tastes like sawdust.
Not very nice, is it? It's actually amazingly bitter. Ugh. Yeah, not as good as acacia. Right. Then this one here is a round-leaf teak, and that one there is a common falsethorn or Albizia harveyi, and you can see all of them here have been taken out over the years by many elephants coming past doing exactly what we saw that cow doing there. And then the other thing that Viam pointed out to us, that I picked up, was that this is the stick that we saw her eating. But if you look around it, you can see that there is elephant saliva on this stick. But I might take this home and try and turn it into something of a walking stick for me. We'll see. We'll let it dry first, I think, before I do too much with it. We'll let Viam sit in it, sit in the back with it. There you are, Viam. I'll wash my hands before I have my breakfast in not too long. Right, we're going to go just past three in a row pan, and then we'll press on to see what is on for breakfast. But let's see if there aren't maybe one or two creatures having a drink at three in a row. I found very little having a drink at Cheetah Plains lately, and I don't know why that is. I think maybe there are a couple of other lodges around the place that are pumping water as well, which means that the animals are not sort of driven towards three in a row pan quite as readily as they have been in the past. It's just around the corner here. And these elephants, I think they've probably been drinking there and they've gone sort of wandering down towards the south. Getting a bit windy, Viam. Right, here we are. And both Brent and I keep saying maybe quarantine male leopard will be here in his favourite marula tree or on his favourite termite mound. I've yet to see him here. I think Brent's seen him here a few times. Nope. There's an oxpecker, Viam. There's one single solitary oxpecker having a drink there. Marily, you're wondering about terrapins and how they survive the dry seasons. Do they get through the dry season? Do they manage to sort of survive in the water, or do they die and then are they replaced by other terrapins? Marily, I think what you'll find is that most of them go into a state of aestivation. Aestivation is a state that they go into during the wet, at least during the dry. And I'll tell you why I'm losing concentration slightly. Just look over there, Vimpy. There's a dove sitting on the ground. Now, doves do not nest on the ground. What that dove is sitting on, I can't imagine. He's just behind. There he is. Marily, I will get back to you. I just don't. That very odd behavior to me. There's nothing there, is there, Viam? There's no eggies. No. Just look like it's sitting on eggs. Maybe it's just being amusing. Maybe about to lay eggs. Anyway, Marily, they go into aestivation, which means they'll find a piece of mud, or they'll go into a termite mound or something like that, and they'll shut down the physiology, basically, the metabolism, and they go into a sort of temporary state of hibernation, if you like. But they are not dead after one season in the water, no. I mean, I think if the dry lasts for long enough, I think you'll find that many of them, especially the little ones, will definitely die. But they're designed to last many, many years. You know, a lot of the chelonids, is what we call them, the tortoises, the terrapins, the turtles, and the... Have I left one out? No, I haven't. Tortoises, terrapins, and turtles live for many, many years, and in some cases well over 100 years. And I don't know if you've read about this thing that's been doing the rounds on social media, but there's a... they found... You know, we're talking about long-lived organisms, we're talking about those elephants. They found a shark in Greenland, the Greenland shark, that apparently is 400 years old. That is quite astounding. 400 years old, 150 before its first mating, 150 before it was sexually mature. Absolutely boggles the mind. 400 years ago was the year 1616. That was before European settlement of this country. And, well, I mean, it's just a very long time ago. Let's head back across to Brent. He's got some more cats for you.
So unfortunately, we can't get the best view of the females, but these two Birmingham boys look very comfortable. I mean, there's a new definition of putting your legs up on your brother. So they are lying out quite out in the open here on Gowrie Cutline, but I'm quite certain they are going to move into the shade later on today. I'm really fascinated to see if these lions make their way back towards that buffalo carcass, the vultures are feeding. I don't know where that came from. The vultures are feeding at the moment. I can actually, as the wind gusts every now and then, I can hear them. And I wonder if the hyenas are going to get involved there as well. Now Paige in Tennessee is wondering, why have Amber Eyes and the youngest lioness not fallen pregnant yet? They've mated with the Birmingham several times. Well, it's not a surefire thing every time lions mate that they become pregnant. That's why they mate so frequently, to try and ensure conception. But sometimes it can take multiple times before their females become pregnant. Oh. So I think this is the male that killed the buffalo. He's much fatter than all the others. And just the smell of that carcass makes me think it's been there for longer than a night. So it might have been there for two nights. I'm just trying to think. No, we didn't come into this area yesterday on sunrise or sunset safari. I know on sunrise safari we were on Buffalo's Hook Waterhole. With the four Inkahuma ladies and the five cubs. And then James, I think, was on Arathusa, yes. And then on the sunset safari, James was back with the Inkahumas and cubs, and we were down with Inkanyeni on Cheetah Plain. So we just didn't happen to move into this area yesterday, which is a pity, but we can't really complain with the fantastic sightings we've been having. I think we're looking at what these male lions are going to be doing for the rest of the day. Now Ellen in Arkansas is wondering, which determines which male lion gets to mate first, or will all three mate? Now, one of the most interesting things about lion coalitions, as the dominant male is always in flux, it could be any one of the four who are dominant. depending on how much he's eaten, if he's got a little limp or injury, or how aggressive he happens to be that week. But normally you'll probably find she will mate with all three over a period of time. But the lion who's dominant at the moment will get first dibs, so to speak. And I think that's the male that is lining up much closer to the rest of the pride. Now these boys, as I said, not going to do too much apart from snooze. They might move into the shade a little bit later, but while we sit here for the last few minutes of drive with the beautiful Birmingham boys, and let's go see how Steph's doing on foot.
All right, now we've probably walked around about 200 yards or so following their male and female leopard track, just to prove that we're still on the tracks. Here's the male leopard tracks here. That's, I don't know what male this is, but it's a full-grown male. And then I can take you back and show you where the last tracks of this female was, and that was here close to this termite mound. Let me show you quickly what we can. Her tracks come here. Here we go. Here's a back pad from this female. Right here is her track. That's just the back pad. You can see that angle there. So male tracks, she's still trying to keep this male away from the babies, pushing the male away from the babies. We think her babies are somewhere here, Karula's babies. She's keeping this male leopard away from her babies, away from walking towards her babies. Quite a common thing for leopard to do. Male leopard, who are not the fathers of these babies, will try and kill these cubs. It forces the female to come back into estrus again. It'll force Karula to come back into estrus again. And that is a way that male leopard will be able to be certain that it's his babies here. If it is his babies, it's quite common for you to find leopard, female leopard, male leopard, and offspring feeding on a carcass together, as was evident just the other day with, I can't remember who it was, but it was two leopard on a carcass. Which one was it? Can you remember? Tingana and? Was it? It was Tingana and, I can't really remember. But anyway, don't worry, there was a male and a male, two male cubs feeding on a kill together. My memory this time of the day. Anyway, what we're going to do is we're going to carry on walking over here. You're welcome to join us for the journey as we go further on. We've got this female leopard cub. She is heading, the male leopard is now heading straight in this direction, which is straight south. We've got a boundary that's probably around about 200 meters or so further in that direction. So I fully expect these tracks to actually cross over. And then I would expect Karula's tracks to veer off back towards her cubs. But it's going to take us a bit of time to unravel that. Obviously not enough time to finish the story in this drive. Hopefully we can finish it in this afternoon safari. And so from myself, Steph, and from Xander and Herbert, we just want to say thank you very, very much for joining us on this morning's sunrise bushwalk. And we'll catch you again soon, wherever you are in the world. Goodbye and have a nice day.
We're still sitting with the Birmingham boys, and they have literally not moved a centimeter. Now, as the day warms up, I'm pretty sure that they're going to get a little bit uncomfortable, as they're going to be in full sun shortly. And you can see the boy on the left is already almost in full sun. Now, Angel's wondering how long after this kill before they hunt again. I think they might even go back to that kill, but one must remember, Angel, that these incredible predators are opportunists. So if a buffalo happened to wander up to this area in 10 minutes, they would hunt. And especially, there's a good chance of something accidentally wandering into them in this windy weather we're having at the moment. You can see all the wind gusting around me, and that affects a lot of the prey species or herbivores, their smell and their hearing, and not so much their sight, of course. But if these lions were lying just off in a thicket here, flat to the ground, there's a strong possibility a buffalo wandering down here towards the Djuma pan would not have a clue that they're there. Now that one lioness who was drinking at the Djuma pan, we did get a glimpse of her. She's come back and joined the rest of the pride in this, in those thickets. I was pointing and not watching my monitor, naughty Brent. In these thickets down here where we were in just now, where we could just make out some of the lions and cubs, but it is very, very thick in there. But I think we're going to leave these Birmingham boys to their schnooze and maybe head down towards the Djuma waterhole. Maybe there's some zebra or other creatures around. Bye, guys. And you can see not even an eye has opened as we move the car fast asleep. Rest of the pride right in this little ravine here. Oh, can you see? I think I just make out the lioness there. See what I'm looking at, Brian? Yes. Yeah, so I mean, can't you guys see the lion? I mean, it's right there. I'm only joking. Can just make out a lioness behind that bush. But it's a very, very thick in there. Well, hopefully they'll be out in the open on the sunset safari. And at least the killer bees mission for the morning was completed. We were looking for the inkahumas and cubs and we succeeded. Actually, you know what? We might be able to get a view from here of the cubs. Let's try. I can definitely see a lioness. Well, I could see a lioness. She's moved. Okay, yeah, let's leave the lions to enjoy their thicket for now. We'll try again on the sunset safari. So, from the killer bees! It's not bon nuit, I can't remember, I'll say good morning in French. But bye, and we'll see you on the sunset safari. Let's go jump on board with James.
We are back at Djuma, everybody. I was just slamming on the anchors there, hoping that we wouldn't lose anything. Signal. We have not lost signal. We're going back down through the valley of the great Mloamati drainage, and you can see the feel, the wind is howling now. It really is very August windy at the moment. I don't think it's going to bring in any weather. I think it's going to just be particularly irritating for the course of the day, and we have to put up our tent today. So it's going to be quite a trial, I had to tell you, after our breakfast. Hello, Sarah, you're in Cape Town. You say, when are we going to have our next fireside chat? And I'm going to ask the director in the director's seat, who just asked me that question, to tell me the answer. Right, it will be on Sunday, Sarah. We will be having a fireside chat on Sunday. I'm not sure how long it'll be. It'll probably be the last 15 minutes of the Sunday afternoon safari. And we'll show you a couple of clips. And we're doing a special on the Bush Olympics that took place a little while back. Eggsy has put together video on it. And it was a rather entertaining day. We had opening ceremony, we had a number of ridiculous events, none of which I won, and then we had a closing ceremony, and you'll be able to find out who won all of those things when we go live with that on Sunday evening. Good morning. He is on the telephone. in the bush. Our very wilderness. Okay. I'm just going to stop here briefly because the wind is mercifully absent down in the valley here. Okay, here we go. Feel I'm at the seaside at the moment. Anyway, it's now Friday, of course. That means it's the weekend. Viam, are you looking forward to the weekend? What have you got planned? Yes.
It's Thursday still.
No, it's Friday. Yes. What have you got planned for your weekend, Viam?
Not much.
Are you going to be taking some game drives?
Yes.
Yes. Me too. The only way we know it's Friday, everybody, is that on Friday evenings, Brian, who used to be something of a DJ in another life, fires up a couple of fairly loud tunes and then announces the weekend, and then things continue as they have for the rest of the week. And this is precisely, I suppose, how the animals feel. They don't really notice the weekends either. Tasha, you want to know if I've ever done animal impressions on the radio? No, I haven't ever done animal impressions on the radio. You've got to be careful of that, Tasha, because people get very upset if you mess around on the radio. One uses their humour on the radio very sparingly indeed. Okay, we're turning on to Djuma, and then we'll say goodbye to you until the afternoon. There we are. Right, now I will sit here and say thank you to all of you for joining us on our safari and for continuing to entertain us with your conversations. It's much appreciated. Thank you, Viam. Big thank you to Brent and Stefan and Eggsy and Brian and Kirsten and Rebecca. And we'll see you today at 3:00 this afternoon in the wind. Bye-bye.